There sure are a lot of bloated carcasses floating around the box office this year, and we're only halfway through. And on that note, here is my list of the top five worst movies that have come out so far in 2017. But I gotta tell you, it was a hard list to make, and here's why. Number one, I try to give movies the benefit of the doubt, which I know frustrates some of you. But hey, I'm just not willing to call a movie flat out terrible from beginning to end with no redeeming qualities. I mean, professionals worked on it. And I think that we all know, with movies being a group effort and a business, that the best intentions don't always lead to the best results, but the intentions shouldn't be dismissed. Also, with quote-unquote bad movies, there's always somebody who liked it, and in some cases, a lot of people who liked it. And I just have a problem with basically saying to those people, your opinion either doesn't count or is flat out wrong. That's why I like box office numbers, because a film's financial success is much more clear cut. But then here's the second reason this list was hard to make, and this is the real stickler this year. And that's that it's no fun to see movies fail, especially when their failure is indicative of larger, worrying trends about the film industry as a whole. And that's really what's going on this year, because as inventive and as revolutionary as 2017 has been with some films, a much bigger part of the film industry seems to be devolving. And as someone who not only likes movies but covers movies, I don't want to see that happen. Also, movies, as we've discussed before, they influence and reflect society, and so I shudder to think what these movies say about society. Let's just also think about the really good revolutionary ones too, right? So this list this year, at least so far at the halfway point, isn't about bloodlust, but these people should have known better. That's my theme. All right, so number five, top five. You're lucky, Mummy, that this wasn't a top 10. All right, number five, A Cure for Wellness. Because really, Fox should have known better than to let the talented, very talented Gore Verbinski go way too far with the final act of what up until that point was a really good Hitchcockian thriller. But rape, incest, sloppy science, and a last frame wicked smile that makes no frickin' sense were really just inexcusable. I, for one, we'll never think of Jason Isaacs the same way again. Where was his management team? They should have said, are you worried about kind of ruining how people feel about you? And if not, maybe you should reconsider. I mean, I'll still watch Jason Isaacs, but there's an image from the end of this film that I'll never be able to get out of my head. Yeah. And speaking of actors, Valerian should really be the final nail in the coffin, but this is the second to last one. And that really, everybody in Hollywood should know better than to hire Dane DeHaan, because audiences just aren't interested. And I have to be honest, I think even from a critical perspective, the guy's just not leading man material. He's a character actor, and I think it's time that he embraced that. All right, number four, Transformers The Last Knight. And I'm sure some of you right now are typing, Grace, you gave this movie a good review. Well, if you actually pay attention to the review and hearken back to what I just said earlier in this video about trying to give movies the benefit of the doubt, I very clearly said that while I really enjoyed the first half of Transformers, the second half is totally unwatchable, which is why it's on this list. And that can be said about a number of films this year, including The Mummy. Again, so lucky this is only a top five. And I'm sure The Mummy has made a number of your top worst lists as well, at least so far. But anyway, and I also clarified that Transformers fans at this point, and there are many of them, know what to expect. So I just said, hey, it's the exact same thing. Unfortunately, Michael Bay wasn't able to fix that problem with his movies as he leaves the franchise. But the first half is so good, I do really still feel it's the best one that he's made. But that's not saying much. And that's who should have known better. Michael Bay should have known better than to keep doing what he's been doing. And that's why this is on this list for me instead of The Mummy, because that's new. But this is the fifth film into the Transformers franchise. And after four films, everyone has spelled out their problems with what Michael Bay has done so far in detail. And I realize, in excruciating detail for Bay, but come on, that's why he gets paid the big bucks to read his bad reviews. And I also understand that it's easy to dismiss the critics when you're making it rain. But Michael Bay has been in this business for a long time, and he should know, as someone who's also a producer, to look closer at the box office numbers and see the diminishing returns stateside. That should have been a wake-up call for him before this entry, which is also doing very poorly overseas as well, with huge drops in China. It's so bad. And also, if he hates making these movies and he isn't willing to do the work and to try and turn it around, then stop making them. And really, Paramount should have also known better, speaking of hiring people, than to make Akiva Goldsman the head of their new Transformers writer's room, right? What did you think you were gonna get? I mean, I know that Akiva Goldsman has an Oscar, but he has a much longer list of movies that have tanked that he's been intimately involved with. All right, number three, 50 Shades Darker. Here, Universal should have known better than to let E.L. James push out Sam Taylor Johnson and Kelly Marcel for the second film, because it was these three ladies' struggle to get along and to agree to what the first film should be that made the first film work. Because as I said in my review of that first film, because the behind-the-scenes squabbles were documented, that sometimes Sam Taylor Johnson and Kelly Marcel were right, but sometimes E.L. James was right. The team was a good one. But E.L. James absolutely insisted on replacing the two women with two men. That in and of itself is a shame because of the source material. I'll get to that in just a moment. But one of those men was her husband, and they turned the sequel, 50 Shades Darker, into everything the first movie and the books have been accused of being. And I guess because that's what the books were, I'm sure E.L. James is very happy with the result. But what started out as an amazingly accurate depiction of a gold digger and the S&M billionaire that she has a chance with because no regular woman will be willing to date him, it just turned into a Harley Quinn romance, and a really bad one at that. And now the franchise no longer has the box office results or fan base to back it up like the first one did. So Universal should have known better. I can't say that E.L. James should have known better because she wrote that drivel in the first place. I just don't expect her to realize how important Sam Taylor Johnson and Kelly Marcel were. That's Universal's job and the producers on the film, on this franchise. The number two is Ghost in the Shell, because Scarlett Johansson should have known better than to not only sign on to play a character that was originally Japanese. I mean, did she not see the Exodus coverage, right? But one that in the script had been reimagined as one that Hanko Robotics literally had replaced an Asian body with a Caucasian one. I mean, really, publicists should start playing guess the headline with their clients. I see a similar one coming up, by the way, for Hugh Jackman's The Greatest Showman, being like, guess the headline, Hugh, about how you totally did a revisionist history on P.T. Barnum, and then this is completely inaccurate and misrepresentative of what this man did and was. It's just too easy. But also, I think in both cases, wrong and should be called out. But here, DreamWorks also should have known better than to hire the director of Snow White and the Huntsman, right? Who was also incredibly unprofessional on that set. A married director having an affair that he got caught publicly doing with his leading lady, who clearly wasn't into it because the relationship didn't last. And then also one of the Transformers screenwriters they hired to write the thing, be one of the writers on it. I mean, again, what did they think they were going to get? And the result, tragically, that's why this is so high up on the list, is a film that not only wasted and set back iconic and quality source material, but wasted as well beautiful and inventive VFX work by industry veteran John Dykstra and his team. I mean, the visual effects are breathtaking. And not to mention, there goes the Black Widow movie, very likely, or at least certainly sets that back very far. I mean, you got a responsibility there, ScarJo. It's a shame. Then number one, Pirates of the Caribbean 5, Dead Men Tell No Tales. But people are telling a lot of tales about Johnny Depp, and Hollywood as a whole should have known better than to not only hire Johnny Depp, but to enable him. Yes, there's a lot more going on here than just the film itself. But when you watch the film, it becomes clear that Johnny Depp has not only lost his creative touch, but that he is a man genuinely in trouble, both professionally and personally. And because of his very public financial problems, he's likely eager to work with the studios and is campaigning hard to be added to not only continue the franchises that he has, but to add new ones. And adding new ones he is. I mean, how does an actor with dwindling box office numbers and who's the focus of rampant rumors about horrifically unprofessional and disturbing on-set behavior get his franchises to continue and sign on for new ones, especially after also killing the Alice movies off? Pirates of the Caribbean 5 is perhaps one of the biggest cries for help and enabling ever documented on screen. it's actually, maybe one day they'll make, maybe they'll make a movie about that, right? You know, feud style. But it would be, I think, a lot sadder. But hopefully Johnny Depp will be able to, I would like him to see him turn things around. And, you know, both behind the camera in his personal life and on camera. Because, you know, he's been beloved for a reason. It's turned out some really quality work. But I just don't know if I see it happening at this point. I would also like to add that while some of you are like, hey, he doesn't deserve our sympathies because of what happened between him and Amber Heard. I think that's a very complex situation that we don't know the whole story about. Amber Heard seems to have moved on. But I'd also like to point out that if Hollywood's going to continue to hire him and people are continue to buy tickets to see his movies, then this is just something we have to deal with. You just can't dismiss it. I mean, either we're done with Johnny Depp or we're not. So that's my list of the top five worst movies of 2017 so far. I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts about them down below, as well as your own lists if they differ from mine. And you can check out some more videos, including my list of the top 10 films of the year so far, right now.